Great. So thank you very much for the organizers. The complimentary set of the organizers to ask me to give this talk. So in the spirit of this workshop, this talk, there are going to be sort of several speculations, but what is not a speculation is actually due to the people that actually worked on this, so Lorenzo and Yuri, who worked with me on this project. So, I mean, this is the setting of a community assembly, at least in theory. So we explored this in several talks, both in experiments and in theory. And so we have a regional pool of diversity, and then through migration, this sort of generates the initial condition for the assembly of a community. And there are several processes that contribute to the final state of the community. And typically, the most of the focus in modeling is on the processes that happens in the local community that shape diversity locally, given the diversity in the regional pool. And sort of one of the key challenge that I think we have to face to understand the limits of diversity in the local pool is to understand what are the limits of diversity in the regional or in the global pool of diversity. And of course, this process is coupled to the processes of local diversity. And so understanding this coupling is necessary to understand what are the limits also at the local scale. The other side of this question is, of course, the contingency of the regional pool, the pool of diversity, is sort of materializes in the fact that traits are not sort of diffusely distributed in the regional pool, at least in general. And therefore, there are contingency in which species have which traits together, right? And again, this is shaped by the history of the community. And one aspect that is sort of it's interesting and mirrors this at the local scale is the fact that in some sense, on the other hand, what we see at the local scale is that functional composition is much more robust than taxonomic composition. So this is especially in microbial communities, there has been a lot of let's say observational evidence that sort of goes into this direction that you see a given environment. And in the top panel, you see that there is a lot of variability in which species, taxa, et cetera, are there. While if you look at, for instance, at traits at the level of metabolic pathways, what you see is that this is way more stable. I think that here there are there are several subtle points, but at least we can sort of start from this observation that it seems that there is a large degree of functional robustness of one end, and on the other end of functional redundancy, right? That the same sort of function at the scale of the community can be obtained by several different combinations of tasks. And the other, I think, key challenge that I will not even try to touch is what determines the pool of functional diversity, right? So at the end, what limits the local community is which functions are available, and there is a process on a much longer timescale that determines which functions are present, and this is again coupled to the local dynamics in a non-trivial way. Okay, so this was a sort of a few speculations and introduction. I don't know if there are questions on this, but I think I can move on with something more substantial. Okay. So the setting I'm going to take here is competition in a chemostat. So this is interesting because it's sort of related to what happens in, for instance, in the gut or to at least a little bit indirected to experiment that can be performed with microbial communities. And the idea is very simple, that there is an inflow of resources from the environment that goes into this local community, and then there is an outflow of both resources and species through dilution or death, if you want. And so species grow consuming these resources, and in particular, one particularly interesting aspect that can be added to these classical models of competition in a chemostat is cross-feeding. So when resources are consumed by species, a part of the energy that is obtained from these resources goes into growth, and another part of the energy goes into metabolizing other compounds that can be used as a resources, as a source of energy from other species. So there is also this indirect cooperation through the environment. Okay, now there is a sort of recent and amount of work on this kind of models, which sort of builds on classical models of consumer resource that were, that starting from McCartan going on, were sort of formulated. And in this equation sort of describes the dynamics of populations of, let's say, bacteria, and the dynamics of concentration of resources. And there are several terms. There is an efficiency in which species consume, transform the energy from resources to biomass. There is the energy, intrinsic energy content of a given resource. There is a sort of maximum intake rate that a species can have on a given resource. Then there is a matrix parameterizing the resource preference compared to this maximum intake rate. There is a functional response to the concentration of resources. There is a death of dilution rate or a dilution rate. There is a fraction of how much fraction of the energy taken from a given resource is leaked. There is the resource matrix parameterizing the resource conversion. So where you intake a given resource to what can be converted, sort of modeling the metabolic network. And there is an intrinsic resource dynamic that I will take constant in the following. So when you see this kind of model, I think that the natural reaction that anyone saying should have is this one, right? So the clearly, I mean, it's something where there are a lot of details, and the reason why I think you should have the same reaction that Munk had, perhaps thinking about this model, is that there are too many parameters and too many variables, too many choices that can be made in this kind of models. We have order, number of species parameters, and I mean, a quadratic number of parameters in the number of resources. And so clearly this scales in a terrible way. And I mean, this is not just a problem of fitting parameters. I think it's more, perhaps this is a trivial statement, but more fundamentally is a statement about what are the properties of the species pool. So how should we choose parameters to describe what we call parameters is actually a property of the species pool. Okay. Any question about this?
No question in the chat.
Okay, great. So one approach to study this kind of models and this kind of system, which is, I would say, is the new standard approach, is the one that was described by Guy. And there are several works also on this model, trying to study the case when the number of species is large and the parameters are chosen at random. So they come from some distribution, and the sort of strength of this approach that was highlighted by Guy is that the details don't matter. So it doesn't matter really what is the distribution, what matters are the broad statistical properties of these parameters. And the focusing is on what are these typical properties, right? And one of the key parameters is how big is the species pool compared to the limit of diversity. And the sort of the interesting limit in this approach is when the size of the pool is order the size of the number of resources, so the limit of diversity in the local pool. Great. I think that there is another approach, which is somewhat specular to this, and this is much less explored. So I think that the only one who explored this is Misha Tikhonov, and I mean, at least in my knowledge. And this is sort of the approach of taking the limit of very large number of species in the pool, where somehow the diversity of the pool is combinatorial in the potential diversity that we have in the local community. And for instance, in this setting, the idea is you have this resource preference and you can take all the possible combination of resource preference. So let's say that we put ourselves in the simple case where these resource preferences are just zero or one. And then there are the species pool is as two to the R number of species. You could take the case where this value can take zero, one half and one, and you would have three to the R species. And then these other parameters, just to start, can be sort of set to respect some metabolic trade-off. And this metabolic trade-off sort of take into account the trade-off between being a specialist and being a generalist. So if you are a specialist, you sort of pay a low cost, so you have an higher efficiency or a low depth term, it doesn't really matter where you put it, and you are more efficient and you have a competitive advantage when you grow on the resource you are a specialist. While the generalist is, of course, inefficient, but can grow on a much larger set of substrates. Great. So this model, there are two limits of this model. So the limit where this cost key, which is sort of cost per trait, per pathway, per gene, however you want to call it, the limit when this cost is zero, it means that basically a jack of all trades is a master of all. So the generalist is the one that takes all. There is no diversity, no coexistence. Only the one that performs all the function and survives. While in the regime where this key goes to infinity, actually this becomes a model of sort of strategy partitioning where the amount of effort you put into sort of the resource preference is total resource preference is capped. And this reduced to the model studied by Misha and the work by Wingreen and co-workers in the case of without cross-feeding and without separation. Okay. Anyway, so in sort of a simpler modeling frame. Great. So so this is the kind of model you want to study. So this limit of the pool of diversity being extremely large, where everything is possible. And the reason why we can solve this is that even if that model is quite complicated, we can write, it exists a Lyapunov function and there is a global stable equilibrium. And this can be obtained sort of generalizing a classic work from the 70s. And in particular, when you write this Lyapunov function, what you realize is that it's convenient to express the variables in terms of the total biomass and the trait occupancy, which is basically the fraction of individuals that are able to grow on substrate I. And sort of all the parameters about the environment can be captured into a parameter, which is a resource quality, which is basically how much energy from a given resource is available in an individual lifetime in absence of competition. Something like this. Okay, so the point is that we can exactly solve this system when diversity is large enough compared to the number of resources. And basically the solution is the following. So this functional occurrence, so how many, what is the fraction of individuals able to grow on a given resource sort of as the solution where there is a core of resources where everyone can grow on. And there is a non-core set of resources whose occurrence correlates is linear in the number of resource quality, and we can get an expression for the total biomass. So what about diversity? Well, diversity is actually you have to count the number of resources that are non-core, and diversity is exponential in the number of known core resources. And of course, this immediately you recognize that this is not possible under competitive exclusion. And in fact, this is just a property of the metabolic trade-off and is due to the fact that we have a marginally stable equilibrium. So we have this marginally stable equilibrium with two to this number of non-core resources. Now, what happens if you have cross-feeding? Well, if you have cross-feeding, so it seems that the result breaks apart. And so this is the same input of resources with different cross-feeding matrices. So with different structure of the metabolic network. So when one resource is converted to what else, but eventually you can recover the same result by sort of rotating this resource quality based on the resource competition, on the conversion method. So also in the case of cross-feeding, you get exactly the same result, and the effect of cross-feeding is just to rotate the resource quality in this rotation where you conserve the, if you want, the L1 norm, so you conserve the total amount of resources supplied. Great. Now, of course, given this result, what you might suspect, given that this is a marginally stable equilibrium, what you can suspect is that this is not structurally stable. And so what if the trade-off is not perfect? Well, you can introduce some variability, again, either in the data dilution term or in the efficiency, which eventually affect is a sort of source of fitness difference. And what you find is that even for large fitness difference, this is a fitness difference of 10%, you see that the same functional composition is obtained and the same biomass is realized. On the other hand, not surprisingly, what becomes what is structurally unstable is diversity. By introducing these fitness effects, you effectively select a subset of species coexisting. And instead of having this exponential diversity, the diversity is linear in the number of non-core resources. Good. Any question at this point?
There's no question in the chat.
Okay. Great. So, now this solution is exact for a finite number of resources and for small fitness differences. And so we can calculate the total biomass, the number of species, and these functional occupancies. And this is valid for any choice of these parameters, of these resource preferences, as long as they are bounded, right? Of course, this is computationally much harder to explore when you take more complicated allowed value for these resource metrics, but all the results are the same. And in this context, we have R plus one free parameters. So we have sort of encapsulated all these complicated parameters that appeared in the original model into one parameter per resource, this quality, this effective quality, plus one free parameter, which is the cost, the metabolic cost. So
if I may ask a question on the clarification for the equation for S star. So yes. Does the one stand for a generalist species and the sum or the specialist?
So the sum is basically you this delta function, you look at which functions are what I said core. So the functions that are at one, okay? Mm-hmm. So you have the function that are at one. And so with this delta function, you basically you are counting the function that are not at one. So it's the functions that are not core.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Is that clear?
Yes. So, but so this is a star is the number of surviving species.
Yes.
Okay.
This is with, let's say, small fitness differences And of course, the fitness differences also affect these F star and the total biomass. But let's say in the limit where these fitness differences go to zero, you can neglect their effect.
Okay.
So the point is that the case where there are no fitness differences are, let's say, in the language of theoretical ecology, structural and stable. So you basically, as soon as you perturb, you have a lot of extinction because you have this marginally stable equilibrium and you have a lot of eigenvalues that goes to zero. Mm-hmm.
Could you remind us what the interpretation is of Fi star?
Fi star is the... Fi star is the fraction of individuals that are able to grow an eye.
Okay, got it.
Okay. Great. So what if this R is larger than one? So we have this one parameter per resource and one free parameter, which is this cost. So what if this number of resources is much larger than one? Well, we can assume that this resource quality, which is effectively the only parameter that enters, is a random variable. And there is, it's according distributed to some distribution. And basically, one can rewrite this equation given a distribution of the resource quality. And one obtains some sort of relations between, for instance, the diversity and productivity. So this community distribution function enters in the position of this threshold here, where resources are non-core, and that determines both the diversity and the number of species, and therefore you get such diversity-productivity relationship, which is a sort of equation of state of the local community, which depends on the distribution of resources, so in particular on the variance of resources quality, and on the on this metabolic cost. And so what you do is that you can do some sort of thermodynamic transformation where you ask what happens to the state of my community as I change the property of my system. So in the same spirit of having isothermic or isobaric transformation, you can take a dictionary of ancient Greek, and you can define the isotonic transformation where you have a constant cost, but you change the resource quality heterogeneity, and you find, for instance, in this case, positive productivity diversity relationship. So you basically fix this parameter chi, which is the cost of consuming one resource, and you change how heterogeneous are the resources. Or you have these other transformations where you fix the resource quality and you change the cost and you find, in this case, negative productivity diversity relationship. So this is just one example of a much richer phenomenology. And this model and approach can be sort of extended to include a cost which is resource dependent. We are working to extend it to beyond the chemostat to sort of describe serial dilution experiments because are more relevant for experiments with alternative form of trade-off. And I think that sort of this approach of infinite species pool can be used beyond the case of competition to other interaction types like host parasites. Good. So, any question at this point?
No question. Okay.
Great. So, one important point and comment about this is that in absence of fitness differences, the dynamics select sort of goes to a manifold, which is represented by the functional occupancies or these trait occupancies. So how many individuals, what is the fraction of individuals in a community with a given trait? And so depending on the initial condition, you go to a given state on this manifold. And so the position where you go, of course, on this manifold depends on the initial condition, but the manifold is sort of, it's by definition general. And one interesting point, which is also was made by Mish in this paper, is that somehow the dynamics depends, I mean, full dynamics depends on species identity. So whether a given trait occurs together with a given, with another trait. So if you are able to grow on resource I, are you also able to grow on a resource J, let's say, let's call it a sort of linkage, right? And the dynamics depend on this variable. So if you write the dynamics for the fraction of individuals that are able to grow on a given resource, well, the dynamics, its dynamics depends on to which traits, what, sorry, how frequently the traits you are focusing on I is in combination with trait J. And this is sort of mirrors, in some sense, niche overlap between species. But on the other end, when you look at the attractor of ecological dynamics, the final attractor is completely insensitive to these overlaps and depends only on the trait occupancy. Okay, so the attractor is completely insensitive. Of course, the position where you go depends also on that because of the initial condition, but the final attractor depends also on the functional occupancies. And so this is, I think, goes beyond the idea of ecology without species and is even the ecology without individuals, where somehow what matters is just the distribution of traits in the community. And when you have small fitness differences, what happens is that you have a fast direction which brings you to this manifold, and then you have a slow direction driven by fitness differences that sort of pushes you to one of the boundaries of this manifold where you have a subset of species coexisting. And so if you think about different realization of the noise, what you obtain is that you have different communities, and you have different communities where you imagine that a different community has some sort of small variability in these fitness differences that corresponds to completely different taxonomic composition while corresponding to exactly the same or very similar functional composition. And similarly, if you think that these fitness differences are time dependent, so you have some noise, some stochasticity, then you have a fast direction that brings you to the manifold, and then you have fluctuations on this manifold driven by these fitness that depends on time. And again, what you observe is that the population abundance fluctuates widely on these over time, and these fluctuations are driven by fitness differences, while the functional abundances are approximately constant over time because they correspond to the fast direction. Good. Any point on these before I say some sort of reckless ideas? Okay. So now, what is a large pool? So the point is that we started from, I mean, I started saying from having many more species than the number of resources, the actual combinatorial number. And if you take a realistic number of resources, you get, of course, a number which is completely unrealistic. But I mean, this being much larger, I think, should not be taken as a sort of strong requirement. It's more a question about how much the pool, the species pool, is representative of what is selected in the local community. And representative means whether the attractor can be satisfied by the species that are present in the regional pool. And also, I mean, in cases where you have rapid evolution and there is a lot of recombination, for instance, through horizontal gene transfer, you can imagine that sort of this state where you find effective, ecologically, you find these attractors can be can be obtained through evolution. And I think that the interest on this is the following. So Guy was describing the case of random matrices sort of the case of a species pool of the order of the number of resources with the random interaction as a null model. And I think that the more successful null models are the null models when there are two null models that are alternative, right? And I think that the random interactions versus the infinite species pool represent some sort of two sides of or two very alternative properties of the species pool. So in the case of random interaction, the pool composition is somewhat the least informative of ecological dynamics. So is really uninformative of the ecological dynamics, while the infinite species pool, there is some information or it's sort of, there is a coupling with the local species dynamics. And when you have the random interactions, basically your attractor is as close as possible according to some metric to this functional manifold, while if you have an infinite species pool, you are on the functional manifold. So in the case of random interactions, the property that emerge in that context are the properties of how far and how close can you be to the manifold where you cannot satisfy, given the species pool, the manifold exactly. And in some sense, and I don't really understand these two sentences that I wrote, but I think that there is something there, is that in the case of random interaction, the functional composition of the community is informative of the species pool because it's sort of carrying these information about the limits of diversity of the species pool. While in this case of the infinite species pool, the functional composition of the community is itself an informative of what is sort of a necessity as an informative of what was there in the species. Now, of course, the key challenge is to is that we should go beyond to having the species pool as a initial condition and try to understand how the species pool is itself determined and how it is the outcome of the eco-evolutionary processes at multiple scales. And the key aspect to characterize in respect to what I said is the functional similarity with the local community, where this similarity is the ability to respect the constraint imposed by dynamics. So a sort of conclusion. So the not the take home because you're all at home. So the keep at home message is that somehow apparently complicated or convoluted ecological models with many parameters and complicated structures can simplify in the limit of this infinite species pool, and contingency is exactly what makes the models complicated. That even in this limit, which is in some sense very simple, there is a rich macroscopic phenomenology and the functional composition emerges as the natural variable to describe this community much more. And I think that the fact that emerges as the natural variable is way more deep than the fact that you can predict functional abundance or redundancy. It really means that what matters for the ecological dynamics is that functional composition. So with that, I'd like to thank all the people that were directly or indirectly involved in this, and thank you for your attention.